So this is a distribution of the metals on the element table, the periodic table we have seen before. All the metals are marked in yellow, and you can see how many of them are there in the table. I placed also a couple of examples just to show you the aspect or unexpected aspect of certain metals. The first picture is dendritic distribution of crystals, which is very typical of copper and of silver. So the idea is that the atoms have certain preferential directions when they are in the molten state and they are trying to build up the crystalline structure while solidifying. This phenomenon is also found in water ice. You may see those kind of dendritic structures. So the atoms add up, solidifying, on the first preferential direction, which is the backbone of the dendrimer, and then they start to grow in other directions, which depend on the lattice structure underlying. So the molten part is helping growing all these dendritic structures in all the directions. Another example, an unexpected one, is that of uranium. So you see a person who's handling with the proper gloves a polished dish of uranium, which has a nice metallic behavior. It reflects light. Actually, all the metals share having in common this, and the variations of their color are not so high. I mean, naturally, you have one metal which is yellow, which is the gold, one element which is pink, which is the copper. All the remainder is in the shades of gray, in variation of tones, tonality of gray. There are no other examples. Second part, ceramics and glasses. So I have marked in yellow all the elements that are involved in the formation of the ceramics, which are basically more or less every metal plus certain non-metals that contribute in the composition of the ceramic to the final properties. Normally, the most important non-metal is oxygen. As I told you, ceramics are metal oxides. But it often occurs that you have also mixed compositions. The pictorial example that I gave you are based on alumina. So, in the bottom picture you see the standard engineering alumina, which is white material that is used to prepare chemically inert parts which do not react very much with acids or other substances. And another application is that of the gems, as I told you. So all those colored monocrystals, synthetic monocrystals that you see, were doped, so were slightly added with a certain element, alien element to the composition, that for certain reasons interacts with the light, giving this nice color. So inclusions of other metals in the alumina composition, for example iron, will give you this color, which depends on the oxidation state of the metal that you add, the alien metal that you add. So for example, in the case of iron, you may achieve bluish or reddish colorations depending on the oxidation state. And this is due to the transition of the electrons. Regarding semiconductors, the group in the periodic table is restricted, so only the elements in green that you see are used to prepare such semiconductors. Pictorial examples are an alloy, a complex alloy, which is cadmium zinc telluride, which has more or less the same aspect of a metal, and it is grown, as you can see, in tiny cubes or tiny slabs, and certain times in wafers. You can see also the polycrystalline structure, which is visible on the surface of the wafer. And the other example that you see is tellurium. This is just like a coin-like portion of solidified tellurium. And you can see from the surface the same dendritic structure we have seen for the copper, but a little bit different in the sense that those dendrites are perfectly orthogonal one to each other. And this tells you something about the underlying crystalline structure, which is cubic. So all the atoms at the macro scale reflect somehow the positioning of the atoms at the nanoscale. This plot shows you how to engineering design and select the composition of a semiconductor device depending on the wavelength or the frequency of the electromagnetic spectrum that you want to interact with. Let's make an example. Let's suppose that you want to realize an ultraviolet sensor. So as you can see, depending on the material of choice, we are selecting elements which have a different lattice constant, meaning that the atoms are positioned at different distances. So depending on this fact, we have a modulation of the properties of the semiconductor, of the energy gap, for example. Each compound has its own lattice constant, which corresponds to a certain energy gap. So wanting to realize an ultraviolet sensor, you should select gallium nitride, for example, which is close to the violet band region. If you want to realize, for example, a laser or an LED which is matched with a specific wavelength, you should create intermediate composition alloys. So for example, let's look at the family aluminum nitride, indium nitride, gallium nitride. You see those lines connecting the points mean that it is possible to realize intermediate alloys varying the composition. So the line which connects aluminum nitride with indium nitride has the two extreme which correspond to 100% aluminum nitride or indium nitride, and in between you have all intermediate composition. So in the middle of the line you will have 50% aluminum, 50% indium and nitride. That composition more or less will be in the violet band. If you want to move slightly down to the bluish band, you should select a composition which is more close to the indium nitride than to the aluminum nitride. You can see also from the silicon germanium family that you will be able in that case to realize infrared detectors, for example, so with a mixed composition between those two semiconductors. Let's go to the polymers. As I told you, the elements that are involved in the formation process of polymers, both natural and synthetic, are not so many. The most important one is the carbon, of course. And I brought two examples showing you the monomer or the repetition unit that is used to create the polymers and an example of the physical aspect of the polymer. So on the left you have polyaniline. Polyaniline is a polymer that has been worked and studied really a lot. It's a nice and interesting class of material. It has many different structures, electronic properties ranging from intrinsic electrical conduction to insulation to semiconduction. It contains, as you see, the classic benzene structure, which is carbon and hydrogen, and plus it contains a nitrogen atom in its composition. And the color in certain phases is greenish, like in this one, which is dispersed in a solvent. Regarding the other example, we have polytetrafluoroethylene, which is very important, very much important because of its anti-sticking properties. Once used, for example, for the coating of all the glasswares or ceramic wares that are used for in the kitchen, but then for the phthalate that have been added to the composition to enhance the processability. This kind of material was banned. Anyhow, it's still used in plastic wares for the labs, for the chemical labs, because of its high inertness. And certain portions of prostheses or implants are done using polytetrafluoroethylene. Its structure, the backbone, is once again realized by carbon atoms, and the pendants are fluorine atoms. Another example of a very important polymer is the silicone. And it's important to observe that in the silicone case, the backbone is not composed by carbon atoms, but a perfect alternation of silicon and oxygen atoms. And this gives a higher flexibility of the chains, because the silicon to oxygen bond is less strong, less energetic, and has more degrees of freedom with respect to the carbon one. So definitely the macromolecules are more flexible and more rubbery. Let's go now to the composites. So what are the applications for the composites? We may think of any kind object that requires higher engineering properties. So for example, we may think of a sports application. Golf clubs, shafts, for example, require extremely high elasticity in order to transfer in the most efficient way the energy from the club to the ball, of course. So certain kind of materials and composite structures were used. Other applications are tennis rackets. Of course, they may cost a huge amount of money, good ones. And they are used in that case to increase, once again, the mechanical stiffness of the racket. Aerospace materials usually require composites, in particular cellular structures, which couple together two layers, top and the bottom, which normally are perfectly flat, to an hexagonally shaped interlayer that allows to increase the rigidity of the structure without the need to have huge masses. Concrete is another example of composite material, because it has a ceramic part, the cement, and a metallic part which is used to increase the elasticity. Or depending on the mechanical stress which is applied to the structure. For example, you may have different metallic steel parts inside of it to withstand flexion or torsion stresses. Another example of composite material is that of heat shields. In particular for a space application, it's fundamental. The ability to withstand a re-entry into the atmosphere, into the upper part of the atmosphere, requires dissipating huge amounts of heat. And this is done either with the ablative means, so some sort of material that burns and that dissipates in this way the heat or the kinetic energy of the gases, or in other words, by using ceramic fibers or ceramic tiles that have a huge or extremely high resistance to oxidation and high melting points. As an example, I have put this information, which is a comparison between the maximum temperatures to which the space shuttle and the Buran spacecraft were able to withstand. Okay, so you can see that the selection of the materials was done also on the basis of the location, in particular close to the wings or to the nose of the space shuttle, you have higher temperatures, in particular also at the bottom of the surface, because when it glides, it is a little bit bent. So there it's where you need to have the highest properties. Those materials require the use of carbon-carbon composites, meaning that you are joining together two different phases, still based on carbon. In particular, the matrix, which is joining together the sheet, is amorphous, meaning that the ordering of the carbons, atoms in the lattice is completely random. The reinforcing element in that case was done by means of graphite fibers or carbon fibers, where the ordering of the atoms is more complicated and aligned along a certain axis. Another example of the applications in the aeronautical industry of the composite material is that of the B787, which is making a huge use of composite materials to reduce the mass of the transportation system. In particular, carbon laminates and carbon sandwiched materials, as well as other components all metallic alloys are composite in that case, aluminum and titanium.